Hello and welcome to VEX IQ Robot Games Camp. My name is Amy and I am one of the VEX Camp counselors you'll be following along with over the sessions of this camp as we build with the IQ Kit, build, drive, and code robots. It's going to be a whole lot of fun. So we're going to get started right away. In this session, we're going to be trying to build the tallest possible tower we can with the pieces in our VEX IQ Kit. That'll help you get to know the pieces and how they connect together so you'll be ready to build a robot by the end of this session. Now, what you're going to need for this session is your IQ Kit, both bins, and you're going to need something to measure with, like a tape measure or a yardstick. So if you don't have those things collected, now is the perfect time to pause the video and go get them and come right back. All right, if you have everything you need, we are ready to get started. Now, as you go through these sessions, of course, if there's anything you need to see a second or third time, you can pause the video, rewind it, and watch it as many times as you need to. Let's take a look at the two bins of your IQ Kit that you have out in front of you. This one here is the electronics bin. I can tell because it's got a controller, it's got the brain. So this one's the electronics bin. This one over here, you're gonna see a whole bunch of long gray pieces. This is the structural bin. So we're going to start off with this bin first today. So go ahead and open that one up. You can set this one aside a little bit if you need to. And check out these long gray pieces. These pieces are called beams, and we're gonna start off building our tallest tower by selecting and taking out this beam right here, and also this one. Go ahead and do that now. Go ahead and take a close look at the two beams that we just took out of the kit. See what you notice. You're probably gonna notice that the beams have holes on them. You're probably gonna notice that on the sides there are these flat areas that are divided by little notches. These flat areas here are called pitch units. So they also occur on the sides of the pieces. And we can determine the name of this beam by counting the pitch units. So to determine the name of this beam, we're going to count first the pitch units on the short side. So there's 1, 2, and then the pitch units on the long side. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So this beam would be called a 2x10 beam. Let's take a look at this one. Obviously a little bit smaller, right? So if we go on the short side first, we can see there's only one pitch unit here. And go ahead and count along with me here. We've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 again. So this beam is a 1x10 beam. The names of these pieces are important because later on when you're using lots of different pieces to build a robot, it's going to help you out to know what their names are and how they are named. So for now, put this 1x10 beam back into your kit and go ahead and take out a second 2x10 beam. All right, so we have two beams here and they look like good pieces that you could use to start building a tall tower, right? But we need some way to connect them together. What we're gonna do then is slide our structure bin out of the side, off to the side, and open up the electronics bin to take out this jewel case. This jewel case is full of pins. These are called 1x1 connector pins. There's a whole bunch of them and you can take a look at it. We're gonna get one of these 1x1 connector pins and we're going to use it to connect these two beams. So go ahead now and take a connector pin and place it into one of the holes at the end of one of your beams. And then you're gonna take your second beam and snap it right on there, and you will have connected your two beams. So go ahead and hold up the two beams you put together in your tower so far. You can let go of it and hold it with a base. You might notice that the top beam just flops over to the side or it droops a little bit. It's definitely pretty bendy, right? We don't have rigidity here in our tower and we need rigidity to be able to build upwards. Rigidity is the stiffness of an object or how resistant it is to bending. And we can see this is not resistant to bending. So what we're going to do is use another pin to connect it. So I'm going to take my piece off here and I'm going to add a second pin to the top of that one beam and then reattach my beam here. And now you can see I have rigidity. It's not bending. So that's going to be essential for building a tall tower. Now you might be wondering what you can do if you accidentally put a pin in the wrong place somewhere. And we have a tool to help out with that. That is called the pin tool. So go ahead and get your pin tool out of your kit. And we're going to practice taking out a pin. So you can put a pin somewhere where you don't want it in your tower. The pin tool has three features. And the first one we're going to use is the puller. That's this feature here. So to get a pin out that we don't want, we simply turn it over, place it on top of the pin, squeeze, and pull. And there you go, your pin is out. So that is how to pull out a pin with the puller part of the pin tool. Now you can also use, and I'm gonna put this back into my beam and you can go ahead and do the same. You can also use the pusher, which is this little pointy part on the back of the pin tool to push a pin out. So if I turn this over and I just take the pusher and push on that end of the pin. I don't know if you saw that, but it went flying off in that direction. So now the pin is out of this beam. And finally on our pin tool, we have this lever here. And you can use that to pry apart two pieces. And I'm just gonna show you how that works. Just put it in between the pieces, in between the pieces that you wanna pry apart. Give it a little twist and your piece will pop right off. So you will probably find that this pin tool comes in handy throughout the sessions of this camp. I'm gonna put it away for now, and I'm gonna replace my beam on here. All right, so here we are. We're making a little bit of progress. We've got two beams together. They're pretty solid here, but, and you can try this too, if I place this on my table, it doesn't stand up. I can't balance it, it's just gonna keep falling over. So what I need is something on the bottom to act as a base. So in order to have a base for my tower, because I need my tower to be freestanding, it's gotta stand on its own. When you see a building, there's nothing holding it up, it's able to stand by itself. So we're going to go ahead and take this piece out of the kit to be our base of our tower. So take a look at this piece here. This piece is called a plate, and you're probably gonna notice it has many similar features to the beams, right? So it's got holes on it. If we turn it to the side, it's definitely got those pitch units there on both sides, right? And again, we can name this piece by the number of pitch units. So if I count 1, 2, 3, 4 on this side, swivel it around and count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I now have a 4x8 plate here. That's the name of this plate. Now plates are different from beams in that plates are always wider than 2 pitch units, right? This beam is 2 pitch units wide, but the plate is 4. So that's how I know it's a plate. It's wider than 2 pitch units. All right, so I've got a base. I've got this tower. And now I have another issue that I've got to solve. I want my tower to stand up on my base, so I'm going to need to find a piece to connect the two of them. Now, as I look at this, I can see that I am going to need a piece that can connect into the tower part and the base part at the same time. So it's going to need to have holes, or I mean pins, that can connect into these holes and the holes here. Fortunately, we do have that piece in the kit. Go ahead and look through your kit for this piece here, which is called a large chassis corner connector. And I'll turn it so it's oriented the same way as my picture. So you can see on this piece, we have pins that point down and pins that point to the side. So this looks like a great candidate for a piece that can connect both to my base, the plate that's my base, and the beam that's my tower. So to connect this, I'm first going to connect this piece to my beam. Now I need to think carefully about how I want to connect it. And I might have to do it a couple times to be sure I get it right. Now I can see that there's some middle holes here. If I connect it to the middle holes though, these two pins are not going to be able to be connected to this plate because this piece of the beam is in the way. They aren't down far enough to actually go into the holes of my plate. So that's not going to work. I'm going to remove it and put it off to the side a little bit. And now you can see that they're sticking off the bottom. So see, I've got room here to connect to the plate. So this is going to work. Now, where do I want them to go on my plate? Well, I don't want them on the end. It's probably going to tip over that way, right? So I'm going to try to put it as close to the middle of this plate as I can. And I'm going to try to think about the entire tower being in the middle. So I'm going to try attaching it right about here so that it, then that one is basically 1, 2, 3 holes away from this edge and see if that looks like it's in the middle. So let's give that a try. Yeah, that works. There we go. Okay, so I have connected my beams to my plate with the large chassis corner connector. It looks like this. And look at that. We are making progress. We now have a freestanding tower. So we're getting close to having the tallest tower we can make, except this is not that tall, right? So I have a challenge for you. So here is your challenge. You are going to try to build a tower that is at least 100 centimeters or 39 inches tall using the following pieces. 2 2x20 beams, 4 2x10 beams, 1 2x12 beam, 1 4x8 plate, 12 1x1 connector pins, and 1 large chassis corner connector. So you're going to go now and build a tower with those requirements. So you'll pause the video and then come back here when you're ready. And then your next camp counselor, Elena, will take you through the next part of this session.
Welcome back. My name is Elena and I'm another one of your camp counselors. So right before you left to build your tall tower, Amy gave you some different instructions on how to build a tall tower and gave you a challenge using a certain number of pieces to build a tower that's at least 100 centimeters tall. So I went ahead and built my tower here, but there's a problem. When I let go of my tower, so it's self-supporting, freestanding, it falls over. So I'm guessing that yours might have fallen over too. Why is that? Now, gravity is always acting on our tower. As it starts to bend over, gravity pulls, 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 and it falls. So now what we need to do is make our tower more rigid and more stable so that it can fight gravity and stay standing so you can create the tallest tower. So what does it mean for something to be rigid? The rigidity of an object, it's another way to say rigid, is how stiff that object is or how resistant it is to bending. Now, right now, our tower is very prone to bending. It is not rigid at all. So what can we do to add rigidity? And that's what we're going to talk about. So let me show you. So for this, while we're adding more rigidity and more stability to our tower, I'm actually going to take the top section of my tower off and move it to the side, just so we're focusing on this bottom section. And the reason why is we want to make sure that our tower is really rigid all the way from the beginning, so that way it's not flopping around at the bottom or wobbling at the bottom. So we want to start with the bottom of our structure to make sure it's as rigid as possible. Now, with Amy, you talked about rigidity by overlapping pins and using additional connection points. So we have two connection points here. We've got two pins between this beam and this beam. But what we can do is if we take this apart, we can add more connection points by adding additional pins. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to leave a space. So I'm going to leave a space for the holes there and then add two more pins. And now I can overlap this beam. So there are three holes overlapping instead of just one hole overlapping up here. And we can see here, it's much harder to bend these beams because they have more connection points, which makes it more rigid. You'll notice you don't have to put a pin in every hole. You can overlap these beams as much as you want to. This is just the example that I have here. So now we've made our structure more rigid by adding additional connection points and overlapping our beams more. How else can we add rigidity? We can do that by adding something called bracing. And bracing is some sort of structural piece or structural element that provides additional support, stability, and helps make our structure more rigid. So let's take a look at an example of bracing. So right here, we have a porch. And you may have seen a porch before that looks like this, but what I really want to show you and point out are the different types of bracing that are here. So you have supports coming up from the base, which we've seen in our tower. We have supports coming up. There's also a horizontal piece all the way across the top. So that's some horizontal bracing, some horizontal structure to provide that extra stability. We have another vertical piece coming up here, so we could add vertical bracing. And there's also diagonal bracing coming from here to the roof of the porch. So those are three types of bracing that we can add, or three directions that we can add bracing to our tower. So the first kind of bracing that we're going to look at is adding more vertical bracing. So we can see here this beam has a point where there's a lot of bend. But what we can do is we can take another beam. I'm going to take a 1x12 and some pins. So I'm going to just put the pins on my 1x12 beam. And I am going to attach it on this side so that it adds additional stability, adds additional rigidity. Now, what you want to do is we can see here that there are going to be places that there are already pins. So you want to plan out where you're placing things. So I'm going to place it just below these two pins here. And then it goes right above the two pins here. So I know that there's space for this beam and the connection points that I need. Now, if I tried to bend this, it's very difficult to bend these two beams because they're paired together and one is bracing the other. So it adds that additional support to our structure. The other way that we saw that you can add support besides horizontal, so we have horizontal supports like with our base, but we can also add supports diagonally, which may not be something you've thought about looking at this kit with how everything is rectangular or long or square, but we can add things on a diagonal too. So I can use this 1x1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. This 1x12 beam, I can attach it using a pin. I'll add it up here. And now if I place that here, I have a diagonal support. So we can see here with the diagonal support. The problem is that when my tower moves that way, the whole support moves because it's not connected to anything. So next thing we need to do is add more support for this diagonal bracing. So one of the words that I've been mentioning as we go through here, we've talked about rigidity, if something is rigid or not, but we've also talked about stability. And I've mentioned that word stability a few times. So stability is the ability of an object to return to its balanced position. So if I push something over, can it come back to a balanced position if I bounce it? Right now, we don't have a lot of stability because when I push something or there's a force acting on my tower, it can't return to that balanced position. So we can add more stability by adding to the base of our tower as well. So we can add additional support for our diagonal bracing as well as add stability to the tower as a whole. Now, with all of these different pieces in the IQ kit, there are so many ways that you can add and expand the base of your tower. What I want to do in my objective right now, my goal, is to attach this to some sort of piece on the bottom so that it doesn't move freely around and create more of that wobble. So I'm going to take another 4x8 plate. I'm going to put it underneath here so I know that it fits underneath. And then I'm going to attach these two plates. So to attach these plates, let me actually go ahead. I'm going to remove my tower for a moment while we attach them so you can see that a little easier. Perfect. To attach these plates, I'm going to use some other small pieces. So I'm going to use two of the 1x2 beams. And I'm going to line these holes up so I know that there's overlap. I'm going to place one pin on each beam, or each plate, excuse me. So that way I can overlap and I know that these beams then will snap right on top to connect these together. Now this isn't the most stable structure. It does have a little wobble here. But this gives me an opportunity to now connect these pieces together and to connect my diagonal bracing. So I'm going to place this back on roughly in the middle. There we go. And what I want to do is figure out how can I attach this piece to this piece. And we can use another corner connector for this, but it'll take an extra step. So I'm going to grab a taller corner connector just so we have extra options. I'm grabbing this corner connector. It's a 2x2 offset so that you can tell that there's an offset between the twos there and it's two in the center as well. And I am going to line that up with my pin, with my diagonal brace, and I'm going to place that in there. And now what I need to do is to connect my diagonal brace to my connector. So I'm going to take a pin here and I'm going to line those holes up and attach them together. So you actually can use these corner connectors with a pin to add additional structure as well. So now this piece isn't moving and I have a very stable structure because you have this diagonal bracing as well as the vertical bracing and a wider base. Now again, this is wobbling a little bit, so maybe you want to add one more piece just to secure it. There are a lot of ways to do this. I'm just going to add another 1x2 beam here just to give it a little extra support there. And now I've widened my base in order to help the stability of my tower. So now as we look at our tower, we can see one side is rigid and stable, but we still have three other sides that we can improve that rigidity and that stability for. We are learning so much about how to improve our tower, and I have one other consideration for you to keep in mind as you start to build a tower that's even taller to compete in the tallest tower challenge. So the last thing that I want to talk about is the center of gravity. So I talked a lot about gravity at the very beginning when we were looking at why our tower fell over. The center of gravity is where all of the forces of gravity are equal on the object. This also can be found by looking for the balance point of an object. So if I attach this back together, make my super tall tower, and I look for where it balances. So it's way up here. That's my center of gravity. So my center of gravity on my tower is about right here, which is really high off the ground. The higher your center of gravity is, the easier it is for your tower to get knocked over. If I push right on that center of gravity, you'll notice it doesn't really move. But if I push higher up, it almost immediately topples it over and it actually broke my tower. So you really want to keep in mind where your center of gravity is, so that way you know how stable your structure is. We can make our center of gravity even lower by adding more weight to the bottom of our tower. So we're going to continue to add structure and weight to the bottom of our tower, so that way it's as strong as possible and you can lower your center of gravity. So these are some examples of different shapes of skyscrapers and really tall buildings that have a lot of support at the bottom of the building. They have a lot of structure, so their center of gravity is lower. So you can see there are pieces where they step through and they have different types of towers. There's one that has just a really big base, a narrower middle, and a pointy top. And you also have options where they're just sticks or spires is another word for them, coming out of the very top of the building to get that extra height. So we can use these as a type of inspiration for how we can make our structure. Now we use our vertical and our diagonal bracing, so we can use something like this as an example, this fourth one here, for adding horizontal bracing and widening the base of our tower. We also can look back at our porch and see all of these different vertical supports here and use that as another piece of inspiration. So having multiple vertical supports with one horizontal piece coming across is very similar to what we saw in those other skyscrapers as well. So there's a lot of common pieces and common design across different types of buildings that we can use as an example here for our tallest tower. So we've already added to our base in this direction. What I want to do is actually add to our base in this direction, so that way we can work on a different type of support. So this way we have support going to this direction, which also helps with the opposite direction because it makes it more stable and able to come back into a balanced position. But we don't really have any supports forward and backward in this particular orientation or this particular view of our tower. So I'm going to take a 4x4 plate and I'm going to attach that back here. I'll use a 1x4 beam for this, in this case, on each side. So I'm going to attach pins to attach our beams here. So you can see I'm using those as a way to support and connect our plates together to make that connection more rigid. We'll make that snap together. There we go. So again, it has some wiggle room, but we can add more support later after we figure out where we want our vertical support to be. So in order to connect things together, I'm going to take another 2x12, and I'm also going to take this this particular corner connector, and I'm going to connect these together with our tower itself. So again, you want to measure the holes that you are using to connect them together. I probably could have gone one more hole up, but this works really well for my structure. And then the next thing we want to do is actually come up with another corner connector for the bottom piece. So I have this one here. Anything that has just one side of connection and space vertically is going to be great for this. So I'm going to add pins so this can line up. I'm going to do my pins diagonally this time. This is another way to make multiple connection points without having to do it in all of the corners. So I am going to connect these together. And I can see that I've made a mistake with how I've counted. I put this too far up, too far vertically. So I can remove that here. And what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to connect my beam using the center pin here because I think that's going to line up a little nicer. So I'm going to snap that in the bottom. And then I'm going to snap that together. And it's a much nicer fit for this support. So now I have a vertical support, a diagonal support, and a horizontal support here, spreading out all of this to make this a much more stable tower overall. So now I can connect the top part of my tower back to my base. Make sure your pins stay in, make sure they're aligned. I always make that mistake. And now, because we've made our base much stronger, we've made our tower more rigid and added stability to the bottom, now my tower is standing up all on its own. I can still see weak parts where it's not very rigid because it's bending up at the top, but my center of gravity has lowered enough and I've added enough stability. That way my tower is still standing. Now that you've learned all about how to support your tower, add rigidity, add extra stability through bracing, through larger bases, now your challenge is to go build the tallest tower you can. You need to do that using beams, plates, corner connectors, and pins. And you need to build a tower that's at least 120 centimeters tall and is freestanding. Good luck, and I will see you after you've built your tallest tower. Congratulations, you have completed the tallest tower challenge. Now that you've built your tall tower, it is time to get ready for our next session. So before the next session, what you need to do is to take apart your tower. Don't forget to use things like the pin tool to pry apart pieces, to pull pins, and put everything back in your structure bin, as well as in your pin case. The next thing you're going to do is you're going to build the BaseBot. Now you're going to find those instructions on the Camps page, linked right below the description of today's session. And when you click that, it will open a PDF. That PDF will walk you through step-by-step on how to build the BaseBot. You're going to be using a lot of familiar pieces like corner connectors and pins, plates and beams, but you're also going to be using some new pieces like wheels, the brain, motors, all so that we can get ready to drive our robot together in the next session. If you need additional help, there is a video linked below the build instructions that'll walk you through step-by-step how to build the BaseBot, and you can do that together with someone on screen. Once you've built your BaseBot, make sure that you have your battery and your controller charged. Now you can find your battery and your controller in the electronics bin. Inside the electronics bin in the very center, you'll find a cable as well as your controller. So you can plug one end of that cable into your controller using this piece right back here. There's a slot on the back of your controller, and plug the other end, this USB end, into any USB port that'll help charge, that'll do any charging. Once your controller is charged, there'll be green lights on the front. Then you can charge your battery. So underneath the brain here, you'll notice that there's a battery that's already slid into the brain. So you're gonna slide that out. We're gonna put our brain back for now. And then you can use the same charger to plug into the end of your battery and charge your battery as well. Once your controller and battery are charged and your BaseBot is built, then you are ready to go on to session 2, where we're gonna be driving the BaseBot to complete a maze. I'll see you next time. Thanks.